see how far I can throw. Oh, I don't know. Good catch. Okay, one more. All right, cool. All right, thank you. Thank you. All right, so I'd like to introduce our next speaker. The name of his talk is Safety Bot Guaranteed. And so give it up for Rich Seymour.
All right, well, thank you, Beth. So a little bit about myself. Safety Bot Guaranteed is the title of the talk. It's a reference to a movie and a meme. Data scientist at Endgame. I have a PhD in materials science. I play bass in a band, and I'm at R. Seymour on Twitter. If you want to talk to me about materials science, it'd be my pleasure sometime. So this current talk is mainly about bots, like chatbots, and their applications. And then I'm going to go into a specific application in safety, and then I'm going to actually show you a little bot that I wrote that helps you go through the safety process. So let's start with bots. I want to thank Bobby Filer, who's here, for a lot of these slides, because he's kind of the bot maestro at Endgame. You're probably familiar with a lot of bots, either for security reasons or for convenience reasons. They are changing lives. If you saw this last week, that's two Google Homes talking to each other. And since that's like a generative algorithm, they came up with interesting things to say. I think that's them Rickrolling each other or getting married, like different weird random things happened. Also, bots can be kind of unsafe or just maddening. I don't know if anybody has a Dot or an Alexa at home that you tell to do stuff and then it does it 90% of the time, but 10% of the time it'll say something like, I don't have that available to my thing. Anyway. So let's cut through the voice recognition and the text-to-speech. A bot doesn't have to have that to just be a bot, right? Like, you've maybe you're familiar with like something like NickServe on an IRC chat. Like, that, to me, is the lowest level of bot, but it's still a bot. Why would you ever want to do this? Well, a lot of interfaces kind of suck, right? Click-through interface can be confusing. You can be searching for where's the input, where's the create button, where's the thing, whereas a chat is going to tell you what it needs, when it needs it, which can be actually much more convenient. So big companies are getting involved. Cause of the bot revolution, excess capital. There are also a lot of ways to build your own bots that interface with things like Slack or Alexa or any of that stuff. You can go to wit.ai or api.ai or these other ones and build things that then apply on those platforms, which is cool. I think that's great. If you want to make Alexa turn on your toaster, okay. But that is not what I'm going to be talking about. I'm not going to be using any of these frameworks. They're actually useful. But I just kind of want to expose some of the guts of a bot so maybe you have less fear when you're looking at them. Or ignorance, whichever. So there are different types of bots. And on your left is the more like future-facing stuff. So that's generative, where it's coming up with a new sentence to say it to you. Or it's open domain, where you can talk to it about, you know, Hercules, the movie, or Hercules, the Greek epic. Is that epic? I don't know. And you can have a nice long conversation with it. On the far end is retrieval, like something like NickServe or any sort of general bot that basically can do one or two things or a menu of things. That's the closed domain is the menu. And then it just has a short conversation and you're done. There are good bots and bad bots. Taybot got a lot of flack for things. I mean, basically it had a Simon Says function, and if you say Simon Says to Taybot and Simon Says something terrible, Taybot would say it and attach the Microsoft brand to it, and no one was happy. These other things are actually very interesting. I suggest looking them up. Do Not Pay Bot was written by like a 7-year-old in the UK, maybe a 17-year-old. And it actually will help you fight parking tickets. And he's expanded it, I believe, to New York, probably San Francisco and London. And then Esther Bot, someone sort of made a QA bot out of their LinkedIn profile so that when someone emailed them, this bot would reply, you know? So you wouldn't have to deal with a recruiter saying, like, will you relocate? So yeah, this goes back into, this is Bobby's rhetorical question, so I don't have a rhetorical answer for it. clearly they both have their pros and cons, but for our use, I think if you just want to make a bot that solves a problem in your life, you do not need to make it a generative bot that can talk, you know, at length about the perils of, I don't know, drug criminalization. So here are some bot workflow and bot vocabulary words: session, identity, a dialogue, context, intents, entities, and actions. These are the things you'll find if you start looking at the papers that are written on the subject. At different machine learning conferences, they go deep on this stuff. They talk about, if you say salt and pepper, how do I extract two entities from that, salt and pepper, without saying, you know, salt and pepper, the hip-hop act. This is, to most people's mind, the first bot, Eliza. It didn't have context at all. It just had matching. So if I say something, most of the time it's going to say, I don't understand you fully, or something to that effect. And then other times it'll say, please go on. But if you say one of its keywords, it'll say something like, oh, that sounds like you're sad. Why are you sad? But it doesn't have a context beyond what you just said to it. So let's get into context. This here is some internal stuff. I don't know if you definitely can't see that. But the context is going to say, like, what are we trying to do? What's our little mission for right now in this conversation? So here it's getting a hash that a user might enter. So you enter in an MD5 that's valid, or a SHA-256 that's valid. This is going to pull it out. But what if you enter two separated by a comma? Well, we need to extract that and put it into an array for you, okay? And if you write it in such a way that once they enter one, they enter a second one, you want to stay in that hash context so that you keep pulling hash entities out until the user's done, okay? So the intent then down at the bottom is, what are you going to do with those hashes? Are you going to check the signature of a GPG file, or, you know, check something against virus total? Entities, I sort of talked about with that salt and pepper example. Entities are the things, right? So you could have salt and pepper, the spices, or salt and pepper, the rap group. And if you have an open domain, that could be an open problem that scientists could be working on for a long time, like trying to figure out the difference between, did the person say salt and pepper or salt and pepper? But if you keep it a closed domain, you can say, oh, I'm just dealing with spices. I'm working on for spice. And all I need to do is pull out spices. Therefore, you're going to drop rap groups automatically, and you don't even have to deal with it. So you define your entities, and then you know what you're pulling out of what the user's saying. Then, optionally, you might need training data to know how different people would ask for something. So if they're asking for a hash, or if they're asking to enter in a hash, they might say, here's my hash, da-da-da-da-da. Or they might say, here's my hash, encoded in Base64, or something bad that you wouldn't necessarily want to deal with, but maybe you could. Now, let's get into natural language processing and machine learning. So this is what happens to actually extract those entities, to deal with an utterance that you say, like, Alexa, go do something for me. Natural language processing came out of linguistics, and in a way, the generative linguistics of Noam Chomsky said that, well, you could probably generate any sentence based on these little things like subject, verb, okay, he goes, she went, whatever. And you can generate these things. Well, vice versa, what people learned was you could also take a sentence like she went and extract she and went, so you can extract noun and verb. That is what natural language processing has been all about. And with the wash of like Google Translate and things like that, people have thrown statistics at it where they say like, here is 500,000 sentences that are just noun verb. See what you can pull out of these. And that's led to things like this, where you can actually download a library that will parse sentences for you. So this is show flights from Washington to Denver on Monday, tokenizes them on spaces, okay, easy enough. Then it actually pulls out the verb, the plural noun, the predicate, the proper noun, et cetera, et cetera. Those little VB, NNS are a, you know, linguistic, you know, assembly language, basically. And you can look those up. But then at the end of the day, you can say, I want to pull out those proper nouns as locations, and the final one is a date. The other option, if you want to go deeper, or at least more on the generative side or open world side, is you would take an utterance, same utterance, tokenize it the same way, and throw it into what's called a bag of words approach, where I've had my statistically trained corpus of all the things someone might have asked this bot, and I want to turn this sentence into a bunch of numbers, an array of numbers, and compare that array for distance to any of these other things I've already seen. So it eventually would like lead you down that thing that says show flights, and say, oh, I got your intent, and I also pulled out these things, Washington, Denver, and Monday. Because you could say, Denver, that sounds really close to these other cities I've seen, and that's measured by actual distance by your algorithm. So if you want to mess around with this stuff, I recommend Spacey. There's also NLTK, but a lot of those other options are listed from Spacey. Zach, do you believe in Spacey? Okay, good. You looked like a bit. Okay.
That's a natural face.
Oh, yeah. All right, so let's see how bots could or can help with security. This is probably one of my favorite ideas and questions you can ask yourself. Is the command line actually a chatbot? Just a really mean, angry chatbot that wants to delete your files and never work? So the thing is, Bash has actually gotten more useful, I think. This is Bash 4.3, and if you type help, something happens. I think there's been decades where if you typed help in Bash, it would just say, you know, Bash not found, or help not found, excuse me. But now you can actually go to help, and this is a zoomed out thing, and I pointed to a command down there that many people don't know about. And, oh, this thing is guiding me and helping me, so I typed help disown, and this is disown. If you learn one thing from this talk, if you use Unix-like systems, it's disown. If you ever have a backgrounded process that you don't want to attach to your terminal and you forgot to run it in screen, just type disown and the PID or the job number with a % in front of it, and that will detach it from your TTY. So if you learned one thing, you learned that. Use disown. It's useful sometimes. Another thing where chat can be helpful for security professionals is something like this with an advanced search, right? You come to an advanced search page and you're like, just a sort of deep breath of like, what do I even want? It says any of this, none of this, some of that. And that could be such a daunting page to look at because you probably only want to fill out two fields at a time. You're never going to fill out the whole form. So it's a perfect example of where a chatbot can just get to the meat of your problem, whereas a form just looks like more of a problem. So you could do something like this. What can I help you with today, the bot says. Show me all processes running, starting in the last hour. On which endpoints? You make this face. They know what's coming. You say everyone. They go, OK. And they give you your search results. So that's one option. Like you said a lot just in that first sentence. You know, you specified what you're searching for and when they occurred. But that would just be two fields on a form. This is just one field where you put in a sentence. Okay. So this is a reference to Bobby's talk that he did at PyData, where he made a question and answer bot that you could essentially load up with a piece of malware, and then that malware, you could interrogate that malware with questions. So you'd say like, okay, here's my hash. Then the bot would assume the persona of that malware, and you could ask it questions like, what are your imports? Or what do you do? What is this sort of thing? And we actually wired it up to our internal chat program, and it's kind of neat. Like it's useful. So moving on to one more way that chat can be helpful. Has anyone here read the checklist manifesto? One person? Okay. Did you like it? Sort of like it? Kind of like it? Yeah. Okay. It's about surgery mainly. But these folks here, GitHub has talked about it, Netflix has talked about it, using chat as a group thing, because you can have two users or five users or 50 users interacting with one bot. You can use it for sign off, checking off on things, making sure a procedure is followed. What the Checklist Manifesto talks about is the difference between ignorance and ineptitude, where ignorance is you really just honestly don't know. Like, you have no idea what you're doing. Ineptitude is you know what you should do, but you just failed to do it. And I think we all suffer from both of these all the time. It's just that the checklist could conceivably save us from the bottom one, where I know I should probably like bring out the bucket first, do this thing first, but sometimes in the heat of the moment, when you really need to wash your car, you forget those things. But now I know what you're saying. Checklists are literally the worst. They're the bane of security. No one's imaginative enough. Checklists are destroying our country. but maybe we can bake checklists into the bots so that we can like actually get some things done properly and painlessly. Okay, now, what I said I was going to do is what I'm doing now, which is switching to safety. And then I'm going to bring them back together, safety and bots, in a little heart. Get your shmooballs out, because hopefully I will say something that offends your core of your being. So safety is not that. I put that on for someone who's watching the stream, and they better be laughing. so how is safety different from security? Any takers? Shout out something? Okay. Safety generally means stopping people from getting hurt, right? Security could mean stopping people from losing money or stopping people from, I don't know, other things that don't matter as much. But at the same time, safety ideas have historically been borrowed by security. So how many people have heard of like Swiss cheese like defense theory or defense in depth or root cause analysis or anything like that? Those are mostly things that came from security or from safety and from accident investigation. So planes crashing, boats crashing, and things like that. The first safety theory was the domino theory, which started with racism and ended with injury. This is mainly for people working in plants where you had a lot of workers on the floor, and if someone made some mistake, you would blame that person. And since they were dead or mangled anyway, you didn't care. But where that went from there was root cause analysis, which you can sort of see the parallels between root cause and domino theory. Fault tree analysis, which is a very complex, like if this happens, what happens? If this happens, what happens? And things like the Swiss cheese model. But what I want to focus on today is a sort of theoretical work by this MIT professor, Nancy Levison, who wrote this book, Engineering a Safer World, that sort of collates her life's work. She started out as a computer scientist and then became an accident investigator. And she worked on, you know, things like both space shuttle disasters and other things like that. So what is, it starts with systems thinking, and systems thinking has been around since these guys. That's Bertalanffy, who developed systems theory for bio, and Wiener, who came up with the term cybernetics, which we're all very happy about. That thing that's in front of them is actually a bot. It's a bot that follows a flashlight around, like a moth. And in 1950, that was pretty advanced. So safety, defined by Nancy Levison, is about sort of these three things interacting, which is hazards, which are things that could happen, like a blackout or, you know, a flat tire. An accident, which results in an unacceptable level of loss for whatever your definition is, whether it's, you know, losing a life or losing $50. And then safety is freedom from those things. And what her main, one of her central tenets is this, that accidents today happen even though all the pieces of the system are still working properly. And I don't know if that makes any sense or not to you guys, or folks, excuse me. But back in the day, if you had an axle and the axle broke, your car broke. That was the end of the day. But now, let's say you have rack and pinion steering. Same thing, if the shaft between your steering wheel and the pinion system, you know, if that snapped, you're done. Today, what do you have between your steering wheel and your front wheels? Does anybody even know?
Wires.
Wires, right? And probably other controllers, you know? I mean, there are multiple controllers that could turn your wheels. And if something goes haywire, it's not because something snapped. Maybe it's because something is, you know, locked in an interrupt or something, but there's not a, things are broken necessarily. It's things are still working, but they somehow push something beyond their limits. So she calls those component interaction accidents. And here's a quote, which I'll read. Preventing future accidents requires shifting from a focus on preventing failure to the broader goal of designing and implementing controls that will enforce the necessary constraints. So here's what it doesn't do. It doesn't use risk percentages of any kind. It's just what I said before. It's unacceptable loss or deal with it. There's no in between. So that may not be useful for you if you're trying to talk to an insurance agent or talk to a budget director, but if you're trying to talk between mission failure and mission success, that's what this deals with. It doesn't look at all the possible failures because failures aren't the cause of accidents. Hazards are the causes of accidents. It never blames the operator because that's a whole other thing we can talk about offline if you want, but operator error basically doesn't exist in her model. And it doesn't triage. It doesn't say, fix this first, fix this second, fix this third. So I'm going to run through how you do this, this STPA, because it's actually relatively simple. The book is also free online. You can get it from MIT Press. It's called Engineering a Safer World. If you like accident investigations, it's got some really good ones. Everything from water supply accidents to Bhopal to... Oh, all the greats. Sorry, a little gallows humor. So the first thing you need to define is your system purpose. What does your system do? I think that may be a stopping point for a lot of people. If you, I don't want to rag on my company, but if you'd talked to us about 3 years ago, I don't know if we would have had an answer to that question. And I think now we do. But this is a really important place to start. Like what does your system do? Now define your losses. What can't you accept? So maybe you can accept all loss, right? like, I think that's actually where this fits in with security really well is like, well, okay, Amazon was down for 15 minutes. We lost, I don't know, $90 million. Okay. Like, it all depends on what your level is. You just have to draw that cut line and go with it. And if you actually deal with people getting hurt, then make that your line, please. And then hazards. What could make you suffer a loss? In our case, that could be threats, like people actually actively trying to steal your data, people trying to harm you or bring down your system and make you lose that unacceptable amount of money, or just someone kicking out the power from, I don't know, your system. So I urge you to also check out Dr. William Young's work. He has worked explicitly on applying this to safety, safety to security for the Air Force. They tend to deal with people lobbing explosives at them. So their value system might be a little bit different than if you're just running a .com. And then finally, once you've defined the hazards and the losses and your mission and all these other things, how can we stop these hazards from becoming losses? And you design these constraints, and there's a very thorough way of doing this. It goes back to this system model here of a control action and feedback, a controller and a controlled process. The issue is, once again, a lot of data-oriented companies don't have a controlled process, except in as much as they're dealing maybe with PII, like personally identifiable information. So you're saying, well, I can't lose this. I can't lose this credit card number. I can't lose this person's middle name, their mother's maiden name. I need to hold on to that data. Some folks at MITRE have actually worked on applying this to privacy. And it requires sort of just changing the words, but it doesn't actually change the results. And yeah, it really is just boxes and arrows. This is not magic. This is not like some, there's no equations really. You're just drawing boxes and arrows and then looking at them and saying, how could this arrow F up? How could this box screw up? And like, if we zoom in on that very top arrow, like, this is extremely high level. I think a lot of this, just this first one is the life's work of many, you know, exploit and secure LangSec folk. Like, it's just that, because it is a really, really, really important thing. But if you draw your constraints in such a way that you know you can't accept UTF-8, well, then just block it. You never have to, just don't deal with it anymore. Anyway. So I think this is a useful system, at least to familiarize yourself with and then say, I don't have time to do it. But part of the thing is, well, it's so hard, right? Like, I don't want to draw boxes around everything in my system. I've got, you know, 7 different servers out there with 5 different versions of Windows running on them. I don't know what their patch levels are. I don't know how they're connected. Well, the beautiful thing is, if you can draw a box around 7 of those systems and say there's no information in them that I care about losing or getting destroyed or anything, you now don't have to worry about them. You can just wipe them off the map. You know, you need to worry about them for operations, but you don't need to worry about them because you've actually pushed them out of the danger zone, so to speak. So with that, are there any questions on safety? Because I'm about to go to the bot demo. Any safety questions? And I was going to say the one thing that I heard Nancy Levison say in a recent talk, which was that software can't cause an accident. And that's actually true. I honestly believe that, because software running on a processor disconnected from the world really can't cause an accident. You could maybe at worst burn up the CPU, maybe, but that probably requires a fan failure, right? So software itself doesn't do anything. It's that it's connected. It's that that screen that it's connected to is being looked at by the wrong person. It's that the printer is, you know, the wrong printer, or the network connection is wrong. But software itself is actually not that dangerous, and especially if you're only talking about like physical disasters, right? Anyway, I thought that at least somebody laughed. So this is SafetyBot. So what if we had a bot to help us with this process? And what if you only had 2 weeks to write such a bot, which is the situation I found myself in? You go back to your types of bots and you say, I'm going to stick with the easy side, right? I'm not going to build a new AI to help me. And then the next thing you're going to do is pick your programming language and choose a language you've never, ever used that most people haven't heard of, because why not? No, it's because I had great people like Chris and Hez to help me out with it. Now I'm going to show you the architecture, because I was told people don't like to see source code. I drew this. What this does, this is a, the safety bot is just a chunk of code, like it's a script that compiles down and runs. There's no outside dependencies, really. And it just asks you questions and sort of runs you through this safety process, at least the first couple steps of it. There's a context manager, which it says, like, oh, you're in this context, you're going to say this. You're over here in this context, you're going to say this. And it passes you through those. And hopefully it outputs a pretty picture. So now I don't believe in demo gods, so we're just going to do this. Ugh. By not being a believer. Dude, that could use it. When is that? Is that legible still? Okay. Feel like pretend it is. It's supposed to be used. Okay. So the bot here, I'm just going to run it. Dope. Bot here says, hi, Shmoocon 2017. I'm SafetyBot. I'll ask you some questions, and we can begin STPA on your project. What would you like your system to be called? Does anyone have an idea what they want their system to be called? Thank goodness. And what is the purpose of the Shmoocon moose? Moosing? How about moosing, at least? Or has anybody seen the moose that's running super fast through the snow? It's just a GIF. Yeah. Savage, right? Fast through snow. Now define your losses and hazards. Loss would be unacceptable, would be lose. And is it an antler on a moose?
Yeah.
People are like, yeah, definitely, definitely. 100%, even though it's felty. That looks good. I think we'll just have one unacceptable loss. What hazards? Cozy bear. Snow. Cars. Wait, snow is, oh well. What was it, slippery something? I did not actually then build in. The next thing you're supposed to do is make a...
Another moose.
That's the worst kind. You never want to run into another moose in a darkened wood. So the next thing you're supposed to do is build a matrix, right, of your losses and your hazards. And you say, okay, well, this loss could be caused by this hazard, and therefore I should be worried about it. You know, like you might say, well, snow is not going to knock off an antler, but a car definitely could, blah, blah, blah. I didn't build that into the bot because I was too focused on this next part. So what are the components of the system of a moose?
Antlers.
Antlers, all right. Let's do left antler, right antler. Any other parts?
Legs.
Legs. Okay. What?
Running is harder than legs.
Yeah, yeah. body, tail, tail, body, right? Let's say that's good. So now this is the part I'm proud of, and you probably won't be that excited since the moose doesn't even have a head. But that's what live demos are for, right? So if I Alt-Tab back to here, it's already getting started building it for you, right? And then I go over here and I say, well, legs, well, let's say body is connected to legs, and body is connected to tail. Right there, boom, there you go. Is it amazing? 2 weeks work. that's that. And then the idea would be if I worked on this thing longer and was actually doing it for work, you would then start doing that process analysis on this and say, like, okay, of those hazards, which ones of these can be caused along this line or along this line? That's the basic idea. And let's just get back to this. All right, well, thank you. That's it. Are there any questions about SDPA or bots?
Were you going to set up to work in like Slack or chat or something?
You could, yeah. I mean, it wouldn't. We've done some HipChat bots of varying degrees, either just like notification bots or chat bots. This one I can open source. Like, if you hit me up, I'll send you the 200 line file that it is. So this was sort of developed like completely from scratch. But yeah, I think you could tie it in pretty easily. Do you think so?
Yes.
I'm getting a nod from Chris, who's done it a lot. He's always doing bot stuff. Anyone else? Everyone wants lunch.
So the purpose of this chatbot system is to basically diagram a particular system to see what
you're
able to look at in a particular case.
Well, I think there's a sort of odd situation with diagramming, right? Which is that if you imagine this had 50 things, right? And I start doing, you know, as it gets more complex, your diagramming software to me starts to get kind of annoying. Like, you start dragging things around and then, oh, I can't fit this thing. This is just using GraphViz, and GraphViz 80% of the time will do an okay job. Then you can export this as SVG or whatever you want and load it into something else to edit it nicely. But yeah, that's the basic idea, is to at least get your system out. And if you were doing this in a group of people that were all working on a moose or working on a car or an intercontinental ballistic missile together, you could really boil this down to a nice set of systems to worry about. And one thing I need to mention about SDPA is that it's a top-down system. And since it's top-down, it's way easier and way more valuable to do at the start of your process than 7 years into your process, right? She worked on the missile control system, the next-gen MIS, or missile intercept system, and it was one of those things where when they came up with all the problems that could happen, like misfires and launches like that, they had already built a lot of the software and written a lot of the code that was buggy, right? Not buggy, it was misspecified. So the idea is, if you can front load this, it is a breeze. But backloading it is a pain. And it's meant to be done by engineers who know the systems they're talking about. It's not meant to, like, some consultant comes in and says, oh, you guys look like you're making a new lawnmower. How are we going to fix this? It's like, no, you talk to the lawnmower engineers and they say, well, I've seen the blades break at this RPM. I know that this engine can't handle that much torque, whatever, whatever. And they'll know what the hazards are and they'll know what the losses are. And then they can fix their system before they ever start working on it. That's the idea. And I tend to think it'll work, but you know, it's a matter of proselytizing a little bit. The book's free.
Has there been any work done testing SDPA specs against like code verification?
Oh, okay. So that's a good point. So he asked, has there been any work testing SDPA versus code verification? And I think her whole argument is that code verification is awesome and it works, and that coders don't mess up as much as people think. It's that the specs are terrible. So when you see, there have been a couple things that we've crashed into Mars, right? And they have crashed a couple times, or missed, I forget, because of English to metric mismatch. That was not because some coder was like, I love inches. It was because they had a document that said program in inches. Program everything in inches. And on the other side, I program in metric. I program everything in metric. It was not the coder like mistyping or something like that. So the code verification is only as good as the spec that it's trying to verify towards. Right? So like C verification, you know, there's still some weird corners in C. So a code verification tool for C, just is this valid C, is going to say, I don't even know. This is undefined behavior. Don't do this. But it's not going to, like, if you have to do that in C and you know your compiler is going to do it, I don't know. So yeah, I think this doesn't work against that. This works against code verification is great. Code coverage is great. Unit tests are great. This works against things like root cause analysis, fault tree, and things that big corporations and big government projects spend a lot of money on doing. And those things miss faults that this finds. And it's methodical. It's just saying, like, if this control action comes too early or too late, will my system break? You know, and asking a series of like 30 questions. So I think it's really neat. There's some talks. She's given a talk recently that does a really good job explaining most of this stuff. What other questions? What other weird questions do you have about bots? Should I say something like, hey, Siri?
Bots
collaborating with bots. I got you. Yeah. Yeah, look at his sign. It says repeat the question. I'm like, ugh. Yeah. Sorry about the past three questions. So bots collaborating with bots, I think it comes back to that, like, well, what's your definition of a bot? You know, I feel like a lot of these bots are like glorified cron jobs where, you know, what you say to the bot is what you would have written in that line. I haven't come across any. Have you, Bobby? No? I mean, but that's what I think a lot of people are playing with that. But the problem is a bot will say things, like especially if you're doing this mapping of like language to intention, a bot will say things that a human most likely wouldn't say, you know? So if you want to go from bot to natural English to natural language back to bot, you're probably much better just developing a specialized communication, just send a blob of JSON or text. Any other wacky bot or safety questions? I'm going to show you guys the code because we've got this room for a couple more minutes. I should have said done, but whatever. Don't even ask why it uses NPM. Like, that's even a more frightening thing that no one needs to know. So this is SafetyBot here, the actual code. I define some of these things like a node and its context. And then step is where it's going from there. And it can have multiple steps from a node. You make a choice, you can pull entities, and entities have entity extractors. So that like when I say connect 1 to 2, it's pulling out the 1 and the 2 and looking up the thing and then doing the connection. This is the stuff to make the dot file, which is the file that does the file that actually gets plotted. Here's the entity extractors. And then dialog is here. What components, how are these components? And now here's the part I really just want to show you is how simple this, how small this is. Like, the whole bot logic is not that difficult. If you look on Instructables, you'll see like how to write a bot 101. And it just starts out with basically, hello world, read a line, and print, I don't understand this. And that can be your basic template for any bot that you start with. Right, it's pretty much just hello world that can take in string input. And that's why I think this if there's any rationale behind the bot revolution, it's that it's so easy at its base level that it's kind of like, well, why not? Why wouldn't I create a bot? So yeah, this is the whole thing. It's pretty much just seeing if I need, this is a repeat or not, grabbing my listening to the person, and then going to the next thing. So, you know, 20 lines of probably inscrutable code since it's that language I told you about. All right, well, thank you for your time.